hold on. At our church, we love God. Make no mistake about that. At our church, we believe in God's radical, unconditional, and unwavering love for us. At our church, we believe that Jesus is God. We also affirm that you may or may not believe that Jesus is God. And we're not asking you to change your belief system before you attend our church. We're simply inviting you on a journey toward Jesus. For years, churches have placed a high priority on Jesus as the get-out-of-hell-free card. At our church, we place the highest priority on Jesus as a live life to the fullest invitation. At our church, we believe every person has a dream deep inside their hearts, and that God put that dream there, not for our glory, but for His. At our church, we believe that the Bible is God's Word. It is real, it is living, it is active. We believe that people who don't go to church anywhere are not the enemy. They are real people who need the perfect love that only God can give. And we believe that God gives this love through, of all people, us. At our church, we do not and we will not display a holier-than-thou attitude toward anyone. We are all broken people, but He is putting us back together. And finally, and most importantly, at our church, we believe that Jesus really lived, that He really died on a cross, and that He really rose again on the third day. And we cannot and we will not candy coat or water down that message, ever. Today, you've chosen to sit yourself in the middle of a very safe place to hear a potentially dangerous message. Welcome to our church.
They need to all be turned in by next Sunday. If you get a tag with money on it, which I don't even see any left, there's a couple of them left, I think. But if you get a tag with money on it, simply put the money and the tag in an offering envelope, put it in the offering box. The gifts, take your tag, attach it to the gift, bring it up, put it under the tree. Now, I don't know about y'all, but I'm here to receive something this morning. The Lord woke me up at 3 o'clock this morning. He said, there's something for everybody here today. Come on. He said, all you got to do is slow your brain down enough so that your heart can open up.
Come on, son.
And if your heart will open up, I promise you,
yes,
you will receive something here today. Because He has something for each and every one of us. Now let's get ready. Let's open our hearts up. Let's clear our mind. Don't worry about what's going on in your workplace. Don't worry about what you're going to eat for lunch today. Just worry on worshiping and praising the Lord this morning.
Yeah.
All right, let's go.
Amen.
Oh,
I just want you to close out all the noise that you've dealt with this past week. Leave it at the door. Leave it outside. Leave it wherever. Throw it in the garbage. Don't go back to it. Whatever you got to do. But take the next few moments and let's just worship God together. So God, we invite you in this house this morning. God, open our hearts, open our minds. Let us forget about all the stress that we've dealt with, God, because we know you're going to fix it. You've already fixed it. We just got to accept it. So God, help us to understand your will. Help us to understand your way. And we just worship you this morning, God.
Change to Thank you. How many of you? How many of you really know that there's no other name like His name? I mean, come on. We celebrate a lot of things, but there is no other name like His name. And I know you might be tired this morning. You might be feeling a little down, but I'm telling you, if you'll just shout His name this morning, if you'll just say Jesus. See, maybe you didn't hear me. I said, if you'll just say Jesus, you'll feel some things begin to stir up on the inside of you. You'll get energy that you didn't know you could have. I'll put it this way. His name's above any kind of mocha cappuccino you can get. It's better than a rock star energy, an AM, and a Red Bull combined. If you'll just say Jesus. Come on, give him a hand clap. Come on. Let him know you love him this morning. Father, thank you for allowing us to be in your house, in your presence. Father, thank you for allowing your people to be here today. Wrap your arms of mercy, grace, and kindness around this entire group of people today. No matter whether they're in this house or at their house or wherever they may be watching, reach out and touch them right now, Father. And for that, we give you praise, honor, and glory. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Come on, give him a hand clap wherever you're at. Come on. You may be seated in the presence of His glory. Amen. Y'all gonna have to put up with me a little while. Is that okay? All right. Catch you up. This will be my fourth message in 24 hours. I am cross-eyed and crazy right now, but that's good. I did not bring my tablet because I need something a little bigger. Okay, some of y'all catch that. I don't need glasses. I just, I think if I figured it up correctly, I've had about 9 hours sleep the last 2 days. But I have had a ball. Our leadership retreat was a phenomenal success. We got to spend some time with Bishop Holmes. All of our leaders went down. We poured into them, and they poured into us. Amen. But we back. We might be tired in the flesh, but we is amped up in the spirit. Can I get a witness? All right. It's good to see y'all this morning. I see most of you. Lights are dark, but I can still see silhouettes. A question, especially in this time, that I've got asked more than usual, Dr. Malt. And I think this message is very fitting, especially in what we consider the Advent season, is how do we find peace in a dark world? And this, I've been on this planet, thankfully, for 44 years, and this is one of the darkest times I could remember, but it's also one of the most exciting times that I've seen. And the reason I say that is because it's all about perspective of how you view things. I believe some things need to be torn down sometimes to be rebuilt. And I'll use a brief synopsis. As most of you know, Pastor Delton's house burned several months ago. Thankfully, they're in a brand new home now. But that new home could not go where the old one was unless the old one was taken away. Now, we don't want to see that happen to anybody because that's a tragic event. But however, sometimes He turns beauty from ashes. And sometimes what you're feeling on the inside has to happen before the beauty can be revealed. And we don't understand it, and we can't explain it, and we walk through the hell that it takes us to get there before we can behold the beauty. I talked last week about the miracle of childbirth and how the labor pains constrict and basically, let's just be honest, are painful. But out of that pain, out of all that anguish and agony, comes a beautiful baby. And so I found the last few months, if you ask people what they're looking for in life, they're not really that different from what they're looking for right now. Some people are looking for money. That's not bad. It solves some problems. And it can save you some time. But does it really bring happiness? Some people are looking to get married. That can be good until it's not, and it happens. Some people just want to be happy. That's not a bad goal to have either. But most of the time, our happiness is based on the events that's going on in our life. Angels announce the birth of Christ, our King, His glory, the highest form that we could ever lay eyes on. The peace on earth. He says, peace be with you. Go in peace. Grace and peace be with you. He didn't say grace and popularity. He didn't say grace and power. He didn't say grace and riches or fame. He said grace and peace. So peace has to be a very important component to God. So what do you really want in life? You got to ask yourself. You should know. You want peace. Money in the bank, but no peace in your heart. A success by all outward appearances, but you're empty on the inside. You may be married and still not have peace. You want peace, but you get the opposite. And especially in this time, we have tension, we have fear, we're full of anxiety, our relationships are jacked up, our friends are torn apart, our families are misunderstood, we disagree on anything and everything, we're offended and hurt by anything and everything, our unforgiveness is rampant, including in the church. So what do we really need in our life? Peace. In Isaiah 26, I'm going to try to put this in context. When the prophet Isaiah writes this, they are in a season of unsettledness and basically confused on what to do next. And he prophesies a day of unbridled worship. Worship without restraint. Worshiping a name that is above all names. Jesus hadn't stepped out yet. And Isaiah's prophesying, if you want to find peace, it starts with your worship. And in 26 verse 1 it says, in that day this song will be sung in the land of Judah. We have a strong city. God makes salvation its walls and ramparts. Open the gates that this righteous nation may enter. The nation that keeps faith. You will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast. You will keep in perfect peace whose minds are steadfast because they trust in you. Trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord and the Lord himself is the rock eternal. Notice verse 3. You will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast because they trust in you. me a little monitor, Pastor Chris. I love Isaiah's promise. You will be kept in perfect peace.
Come on. Come on.
Sounds like peace that transcends understanding. See, we're more familiar with imperfect peace. Can anybody in here relate?
Come on.
I'm good. I'm good. How many of you say that? You okay, Dr. Mo? I'm good. I'm fine. I'm okay.
You're okay.
God, I'm trusting you.
Come on.
I'm just going to hold on to God. And secretly on the inside, you're saying, God, where in the world are you?
Come on. Amen.
Amen.
But he says that I'll be kept in perfect peace. The Jewish word there is shalom. Does anybody want to take a stab at what shalom actually means? It means wholeness, completeness, fullness of peace. And it's a Jewish greeting. So I would walk up to my brother and go, shalom. That means I want you to be complete, wrapped in the fullness of his peace. What if we actually greeted each other that way? What if I greeted the peace of God? What if I greeted my circumstances with the peace of God? Isaiah writes it this way. Be kept in shalom, shalom. He said it twice. Double portion.
Come on,
come on.
I'm not only going to give you a portion of peace, I'm going to give you the fullness.
Come on.
Yeah.
Of it. Can we agree to say he's trying to give us perfect peace?
Yeah.
Peace that we've never known. Peace doesn't mean no trouble.
That's right.
It doesn't mean that you won't have problems.
Amen.
It doesn't mean that nothing ever breaks and that things don't tear up and your spouse don't get on your nerves because you don't put the dishes in the dishwasher the right way or fold towels in the right way. Okay, I'm all by myself up here.
Amen.
Peace is not found in the absence of problems. True peace is found in the presence of the Almighty God. Peace is God's presence. It's God's perspective, and it's God's assurance. You want to feel good about something? Get in his presence. You want answers to a circumstance? Get in his presence.
Come on.
You want to figure out how to have a breakthrough? Get in his presence.
Yeah.
How do you get in his presence? According to Isaiah, it starts with worship.
Come on.
Yeah. Yeah.
It says when the angels announced that for unto us a child is born, it said that three kings saddled up and rode to worship him.
Yes. Come on.
Not regular people. Three kings.
Yes. Yes.
Come on.
It starts with worship. Even in the middle of life's craziest problems. When your marriage falls apart, when you find out your child's on drugs, when you've been betrayed, when you've been lied to, when you've been walked out on, when your physical body hurts, when your joints ache, when you have no way to turn.
Yes.
Even in the middle of a pandemic.
Come on.
Even when you're sick and can't pay your bills.
Come on.
Even when you're laid up in a hospital bed not knowing whether you're going to live or die.
Yes.
Even in the middle of the most chaotic situations,
hallelujah,
if you can get The battle starts in our mind. Anybody else ever had a war in your mind? You being pulled to and fro and tossed around? Okay, I'm no one. It might not be hard for you to believe what God says sometimes, Willie, but sometimes for me, it's hard to just lean on His Word. You got to teach yourself before you can reach yourself. That's a t-shirt. It gets hard. But in verse 3 it says, you will keep in perfect. You will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast. Get your head right. That's what coaches used to tell us all the time, Lloyd. Before you go in the game, you got to get your head right. Be focused. We need a hype team out there under the canopy when they're pulling up, Keith. And they get out of their car and they walk up instead of, hi, welcome to the White House. Y'all just slap fire on them. Get your head right. You need to walk in the house. Get ready. Ooh, bumping chest and everything. Passing out holy pads up in here. Get, headbutting each other. Got my game face on today. We finna go into hell, take our peace back. Yeah. You know, that sounds funny, but that's kind of really what we need to do mentally. Yeah. When our feet hit the ground in the morning, I wish hell would say, uh-oh, he's up. You need to look in the mirror and get your head right. Say, self, you need to line up. All that craziness that's running around in your head, telling you all these lies, you need to go. Turn you on some worship music. I don't care what it sounds like. If you like opera, play opera. If you like rap, play rap. If you want to crank it like a chainsaw, crank it like a chainsaw. Some of y'all don't know what that is. Our kids know that song. It's Family Force 5. It is Christian. I know people's Googling it right now online. Crank it like a chainsaw. We're going to cut that one up. Yes, sir, we are. That's how you cut down the doors of hell. You take a chainsaw with you.
Come on.
Notice Isaiah didn't say that perfect peace would come to everyone's mind who was set on CNN.
Come on now.
Or Fox. Come on. Or the Daily Wire. He didn't say peace would come to those that's fixed on what the future's holding or what our financial situation is or that we got bad news from the doctor. He said our minds, peace comes when our minds and our thoughts are fixed on Him.
Amen.
Yes.
Samach, another Hebrew word that's used when Isaiah's talking about it, says to lean on completely, to fully rest oneself. You'll be kept in perfect peace when your mind learns to lean on God. Amen. And that's hard for us that are educated. Jerry Clower, Lord rest his soul, had a saying that I love to live by. Sometimes people are educated beyond their own intelligence. You read all the books you want, and I'm all for education. Trust me, I will never tell anybody not to further educate themselves. You need to educate yourself. Because everybody's throwing information at you and you need to learn what's right and what's not. The thing is, usually what goes in comes out. And if it's not filtered properly, you can sound as ignorant as the people that gave it to you. It's okay not to know. It's not okay to continue being happy there. When you learn to lean on God, Everything goes through the God filter. God, what are you saying? That sounded really good when Pastor Delton stood up and he was just boom, 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 dropping it. That sounded really good, but what are you saying about it? That guy's poured into my life for 10 years, but what are you saying about it? God will speak if you'll listen. But sometimes we would rather have it our way than have it His. What is our minds fixed on? Is my mind fixed on the cute girl that just walked by in the gym? Always quiet in the house. That's another sermon, though. What consumes your mind will dictate the direction you end up in. It will cause what we like to call spiritual drift. If you've ever been in a boat and been in the water and the wind blows, if you are not anchored properly, you will begin to drift. So we ask ourselves, what is our focus on? Are we worried about finances? Are we worried about politics? Are we worried about COVID?
Come on.
What's going wrong? What could go wrong? What has went wrong? What I don't like? What I'm scared of? My friend drives me crazy. My spouse drives me crazy. There's all kinds of things that we have an opportunity to focus on, but God is saying, focus on me. So where are we focused? Philippians 4:8-9 says, fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise.
Yeah.
Then God will be with you. Y'all want me to read that one more again? It says to fix your thoughts.
Yeah.
You ever been fixated on something? Some of you are fixated on stuff right now. I've probably said something somewhere in this message that's got you chasing a bunny rabbit. He's in my mess. He's on my porch. Well, you know what? I can't preach something that I ain't lived through.
Yeah, come on.
Fix your thoughts on what is true. Not what you want to be true. What is honorable, what is right, what is pure, what is lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise.
Yeah.
I can think of one thing right now that trumps every other problem I could have.
Come on.
Come on. That's right.
And He is worthy of praise.
Yeah. Amen.
And it said, then the God of peace will be with you. So if you ain't got no peace in life, I just told you how to get it.
Come on. Come on.
It's right there. Ain't God good?
Amen.
I'm trying to get it. Ain't God good? That's a good version. See, because His promises are true. His word never fails. He'll never leave me nor forsake me. When I'm lost, He's my guide. When I'm weak, He's my strength. When I'm hurting, He's my comforter. Nothing can separate me from the love of my God. John 14:27 puts it this way. It's a peace that won't make sense without Christ, because He said, peace I leave with you. I got to go, Jeff, but peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. You didn't have to earn it. He just gave it to you. I do not give as the world gives. So do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. You ought to slap three people on your road and say, He's talking to you. Y'all didn't realize that song that was released years ago, Don't Worry. Oh, be happy. That's a Christian song. I don't know the rest of the lyrics. Yeah, I do. Here's a little song I wrote. Might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry. Be happy. Look at all of you smiling. Even the part you don't know. Oh, ooh, I can't get my voice a shot. If you look in your mirror and start singing that in the morning, you will start smiling. I don't care how mad you are. There's some songs you cannot help but start humming and singing, and something in you changes. Like, what a beautiful name it is.
Yes. Come on.
He's a way maker, a miracle worker. There's certain things, if you don't even have to know all the words, you just get some of them right, hum the rest. Jesus said, my peace I give you. I'm not giving you a peace. I'm giving you my peace.
Yes.
I wish somebody could feel the weight of that. Felicia, I'm not just going to give you a peace. I'm going to give you my peace. I could go around and call everybody's name in here and say he's not giving you a peace. He's giving you his peace. You're that important, Gary, that he's giving you his peace, not a piece of peace, not a little sliver of peace. He's giving you his peace. And I want you to look how strategic he was when he said this, Pastor Dylan. Most people miss this. In John 14, remember what I just said. Peace I leave with you. It was the night before his greatest suffering.
Yeah. Come on.
Yeah. He knew what was coming. And he was full of peace. How many times have you been scared of a report you got from a doctor?
Come on.
Amen. I just don't know what I'm going to do. Thank you for being honest, baby. I got you.
Come on.
You just didn't know. Had a lady this week say, I'm probably not going to make it off the table. That's the way to look at it. Why don't we just kill you before you get there? Why wait? I know people right now, if I get the COVID, I'm going to die. Why wait? Jump in traffic. Well, that's stupid. Well, so is the way you're thinking right now. I shall live and not die. That's what you need to say. Why? Because Daddy said it. Now, I understand, according to the Word, there is a time appointed to man to die. But if it ain't your time, you ain't leaving.
Amen.
You done knotted up with fear. Lost 27 pounds in 24 hours. You so worried. You hadn't ate in 3 weeks because your tooth hurts. Next thing you know, you went from having what was a simple cavity in your brain. You done got on WebMD.
Oh, Lord.
You got 19 diseases. Two of them ain't even been discovered yet. And all you need is a dentist. You done called 9 people, got on 6 prayer lines. Done wrote 3 checks to you, my favorite preachers. I will give you a prime example. My wife, whom I love, had already diagnosed herself with the COVID Wednesday. Because she got a phone call from somebody that she was close to that had a false positive. But to show you how crazy the false positive person was, they had 2 more tests in 24 hours. I need to know. I need to know. They don't make them crazy. The media has made us bonkers. I got this back. What am I supposed to do? I don't know. Have you another test? No, I'm giving advice. Lock yourself in the house. That's what everybody else said. That ain't good. I know your family. Y'all kill each other.
Come on.
Different story. Y'all need space. So then the second test comes back. So, well, that was negative. So is the first one a lie or is this one a lie? Mm-hmm. What do I do? I need a third. I need a tiebreaker.
Wait, 2 out of 3.
Hey, 2 out of 3 gets you in the Hall of Fame, baby. So what do? You lean on medical professionals. Well, I don't think that second one was, it might have been faulty. What about the first one? Well, I'm gonna take that last one, but I gotta wait. It ain't instant. Gotta wait for it. Ain't it just like God put you on hold sometimes?
Come on.
Watch your life go cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. Then I had somebody else call me. It's a completely different story. Same day. I need your judgment on something. What you mean, my opinion? No, I need you to render a judgment. Hold on. We ain't in court. What are we doing? Y'all are not throwing me out there like this. Something happened. Some people I work with tested positive. I didn't. Not me personally. I need to know what to do. What does your test say? Did it do what you were doing? I don't know.
Thank God and go back to work.
That's what I'm saying. Praise God. Until you are there, you don't know. Your mind will mess with you. I will give you a prime example. If you have never done this, I highly advise you do it. And if you would like to, I will arrange a time you can. We have a device called an Oculus. It is a virtual reality device. My leadership had to walk the plank this week. Most of them were unsuccessful. You put a headset on, and it takes you to a virtual reality, a wonderful city, to show you how things that you see with your natural eyes will mess you up. Follow me, I'm going somewhere. They put it on, and they look around. Oh, this is a beautiful city. They are in the living room of a beach house. They have not left. Man, look at the cars. Look at the skyscrapers. Wow, these are big buildings. Get on the elevator. Push the button. This is what they look like. Doors close. Elevator music plays. Ashley starts laughing. I can see through the cracks. We going up. It opens up. Everybody's reaction was the same, Dr. Maul. They were happy till the doors open. Whoa. Because all you see, you're about 80 stories up, and there's a little 2x6 board hanging out. And you got to walk it. You know what the most popular saying was? I can't see my feet. They all trying to find their feet. I walk by faith. Not by sight. If I'm trying to find my feet, I'm believing in my own foundation. Instead of where the steps of a righteous man are ordered. And see, when you step out on that board, it makes the board creaks. You feel the board move. You on a flat surface. You ain't got no chance of getting hurt. Unless you do like me. I jumped off and tried to land like an 82nd Airborne paratrooper. Because when I hit the ground, I collapsed to the ground. Like they broke both my legs. And I knew I was standing on a flat surface. But your mind will take you somewhere else. And you will believe in something that's not real. Enough that I had people whose legs were shaking. Their hands were sweating. Their hands were shaking, and they're walking across the living room floor. All because of their vision was being manipulated. Amen. Amen. Come on. Their hearing was being manipulated. You heard a board creak, you automatically thought, it ain't gonna hold me. I'm gonna slip. Jonathan's back here, Jonathan Lemon. Jonathan was funny, he got about 2 foot out there. And he won't walk like this. He's walking like he's doing the cha-cha slide. And he gets about halfway out, and all I did was tap him. I just said, and he falls. He shakes upon the impact. Woo, I thought I'd die. I said, what'd you see? White light. Well, you went to heaven. I mean, the whole body locked up. Why? Because it's crazy what your mind will do if you allow it to run. So sometimes, you know what, Pam? If you put that on and just close your eyes, you can just walk freely. Even if you fall, you don't know, because the Master's got you. See, even when I fall sometimes, I don't register, because he still got me to pick me right back up. But I have to learn to be in his presence. I have to learn to focus on him. See, the disciples were on the boat, and a big storm blew in. The disciples were freaking out. Jesus was taking a nap. There were 2 storms that day, though. Y'all don't read about them, do you? You didn't realize there were 2 storms, right, Pastor John? Y'all said, wait a minute, I didn't read that. There was one on the outside that they could see, but there was a bigger one going on the inside.
Come on, man.
Yeah. I can hold it together in front of you. You don't know what the inside of me is going through.
Come on.
And most of the time, the ones on the inside are so much worse. Look at the disciples, their vocabulary. You know how many miracles they've seen this man do?
That's right.
They mad because he's asleep. Don't you even care if we die? We're going to drown. Don't you love us? Oh, they went straight to that one. Jesus walks out and says, peace, be still. Don't miss this. Go ahead and hit some music. Jesus walks out on the bow of the boat, and Gary, he says, peace, be still. Now, I don't picture it like the old biblical movies, like when Charlton Heston come down with the Ten Commandments and all that. I don't think Jesus walked out there, and in this big old voice, he said, peace, be still. I don't think it was that climactic. I think Jesus rolled over, looked at 12 people he was closer to than anything in the world, and says, how long have you been walking with me? And you still scared to death? How many times have I brought you through situations and you still doubt? How many times have you seen me open blind eyes and lame people get up and walk, but yet you still were caught up in the storm? And he walks out and he says, peace, be still. Don't miss what I'm fixing to say. You cannot speak what you don't have.
Dang, come on.
I'm just going to stare here for a minute because I'm about to lose it. We are taught all through Scripture to speak to our problems. Speak to the mountain. You cannot speak what you don't possess. I cannot speak peace to my problems if I don't possess it. Ultimate peace, said in John 14, my peace I give you. kept in perfect peace with our minds fixed on Him. I have to train my mind to focus, not occasionally, but all day. I need to be able to focus on Him, Pam. All day and all night. See, praising God's easy when things are good. When it's easy to have peace when things are good. It's easy to praise when things are lining up like they're supposed to, Jeff. But that's not real praise. Real praise comes in the middle of adversity. See, that's the kind of praise that the devil hates. We talk about wanting to get heaven's attention. I want a praise that rattles hell's foundation. See, that kind of praise makes demons flee. See, that's perfect peace. See, let me give you a synopsis. What the devil wants you to do when you get a bad report or something negative is happening in your life, he wants you to think of every reason you've done something to keep God from interfering. Well, the reason that happened to you was.
Come on.
And he wants to straddle you up with this thing called depression and anxiety and fear, and you're walking around, and the first thing you begin to do is doubt yourself.
Yes.
And you begin to doubt God. God, do you even care? Are you even listening? What God is looking for is when you get that same bad report or those same negative things are happening, that you can hold your head up, maybe with tears in your eyes and tamarind lips, and your voice might even be cracking, but you can say, I'm fearfully and wonderfully made in your image. Yea, I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. I wish somebody could just close your eyes right now and start walking and not worry about what's going on right now. Philippians 4, 6 and 7 says, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God that transcends all understanding will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. It's the peace of God, not the world's peace. The world didn't give it, Troy. And the world sure can't take it away. Peace is never found in the absence of problems. It's always found in the presence of God. Bow your head. Father, first of all, I want to give you glory. Everybody in this room has lost focus at one time or another. And we've got enamored with our situations and our surroundings. And we've become so consumed with what is being fed to us sometimes we can't see you. Right now, I'm asking that you remove the fog. Let us close our eyes and open our spirit. And Father, let us seek your presence like never before. Father, this country needs your peace. Not a false sense of hope. Not a false sense of security. But right now, Father, I need the rock. I need the cornerstone. I need you to be my foundation. I need you to be the name above all names in my life. I not only lose look at you as my Savior, but I worship you as my King. Father, I ask right now. I know there's people in here that are struggling. I ask that you just begin to tap on their hearts. That no matter what may be clouding their view, let them see you in the middle of it all. Wipe away every tear that has temporarily blinded them. And recreate in them a desire to chase after you. Because it's in your presence we find peace. Amen. I love you guys more than you ever know. Go in the love of the Lord. Let this be not only a Christmas season, not only an Advent season, but a real season in the middle of chaos that we can show peace to a world that's upside down. Next week, they have something special planned for you, so pack the house. I love you guys. Be blessed. Y'all know where the offering plates are. You know if you give digitally how to do it. We love y'all. Be careful. Be safe. See you Wednesday.
Okay. fails